忍びよ、目覚めてください。あなたの主のために。
What's up? What's up? What's up, everyone? Welcome back to another session of Coffee and Martial Arts. Salud, salud, salud. Cheers. Oh, yes. And we are back. And we have an amazing show today. We have a very good subject. And for that, we're going to bring in our Japanese culture expert and Kenpo sensei, Axel Cardenas.
Bonsai, my friend. Hello, everyone. Thank you for watching this broadcast.
Muy buenos días, mi estimado. Good morning.
Muy buenos días, maestro.
Okay. Before we start, let me say some of the, déjame decir algunos de los avisos. Okay. So, let's see. Remember that we are going live through Facebook in our Master Frank Soto Kinetic Dragon fan page. You can see it right there in the bottom of the screen. Okay. Also, you can see us on YouTube on the Kinetic Dragon channel. Just go into YouTube, Kinetic Dragon, subscribe, click on the little bell, and that way you'll get a notification every time we go live, okay? We're also going live on Facebook on the International Hall of Fame, with a C, Internacional, because in Espanol, Hall of Fame, right? That's the fan page from the Argentinian magazine, the International Hall of Fame magazine. It's a very good magazine. It's also still printed on paper, okay? So we are going there, and we go live every Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday, okay? Just make sure you like and share this video, and please, please, please leave a comment here. We are here for you, okay? So today we have our section of Budo no Seishin with Kenpo Sensei Axel, okay? And we're going to be talking about the first black belts in history, okay? But before we go there, we have somebody saying hello, Dexter James. Hello, sir.
Hello, Dexter James.
Thank you for being, for watching the show, okay? So our salute all the way to the UK, the United Kingdom. Yes, sir. Okay, so I believe I'm right. I hope I said it correctly. Okay, so let's begin. Adelante, mi estimado sensei.
Okay. Pues bien, como siempre, comenzamos con el contexto. Esto comienza, la instauración del concepto de cinturón negro es prácticamente transferir el si bien recuerdan, a nuestros seguidores más antiguos, hicimos hace un tiempo atrás un video que hablaba sobre jutsu y sobre do, y sobre por qué se creó el do propiamente tal.
Okay, so usually when we start with a context, okay? So here we're going to start talking about the black belts, right? The first black belts. But before we do that, let's remember, if you've been watching us for a while, one of the first videos we did in English was the video talking about the jutsu versus do.
En esos videos hablábamos de que la era Meiji, Japón tenía que adaptarse adaptarse como nunca antes lo había hecho a las normas internacionales, y eso incluía que aquellas artes de guerra dejasen de ser practicadas.
Okay, so in that particular session of Coffee and Martial Arts with Budo no Seishin, then we talk about the jutsu versus the do, we talk what happened in the Meiji era, okay, which was at the beginning of, at the second half of the 1800s or the end of the 1800s. And what happened there, Japanese people had to put down their weapons, basically, and adapt to an era of no war, okay? And the security was not in charge of the individual anymore, but in charge of the government.
Eso incluía a todas las artes marciales que por siglos y generaciones, familias llevaban practicando, lo cual no hizo más que impactar más en la sociedad, en la mente y en el corazón de muchos japoneses.
So that included letting go of their martial arts, basically, and stop practicing them, stop using them, and that created a bigger impact in the Japanese people, in their minds and their hearts.
Una de las varias artes marciales que se practicaban como artes de guerra, probablemente tal, era el conocido jiu-jitsu. Y una persona tomó el desafío de decir, vamos a crear un arte marcial diseñada para el deporte. Y esa persona es Kano Jigoro.
Okay, so one of these arts that had to change, that couldn't be, or stop practicing, was the well-known art of jujutsu. And there was this individual that took the challenge to adapt the art to the new era. And that individual, that well-known individual in history, was Jigoro Kano.
Él, una persona que poseía una educación muy completa, entendió que había que, para estandarizar con los con las para estandarizar con las con los requerimientos del mundo exterior, tenía que hacer que el arte propiamente tal, el deportivo, fuese una carrera. Como cuando estudias medicina, filosofía, doctorado, etcétera, y cuando tú alcanzas un nivel de maestría apto en tu carrera, tú te gradúas como profesor, como arquitecto, como dibujante, y en este caso, como un practicante de este deporte basado en combate. Y ese título de graduación era el cinturón negro.
So, Mr. Kano understood, he was a very well-educated person, right? So he understood that in order for him to have success with this changing the art into a sport and launching the sport, he needed to generate a standard, okay, to fit into the outer world or the outside world, okay? And so he created a career, or he thought, in terms of a career, like a lawyer or an engineer or a doctor, right? So once you gain mastery or you become an expert in that's when you graduate, right? Like when you get a title or a degree. And this degree was the black belt.
Entendiendo que en un principio existía el cinturón blanco, donde tú eras el aprendiz, y cinturón negro, donde ya eras el graduado. Al pasar el tiempo y al tener alumnos que en un principio, Jigoro Kano comenzó con 12 colchonetas, no, y sí, 12 colchonetas y 9 alumnos en el Kodokan a enseñar a puertas abiertas, sin secretismos propios de la época, o sea, propios del ciclo de generación de artes marciales, hacían de manera abierta, con un estándar de requerimientos de enseñanzas que era todo transparente. Y ese fue el comienzo. Y ahí ingresan dos personas dentro de sus primeros alumnos, que es el sensei Chiro Saigo y el sensei Tomita.
Okay, so when Jigoro Kano Sensei started teaching, he opened the doors of his Kodokan dojo, and his dojo only had 12 mats, right? Like 12 pieces of mats, okay, as we know, like the ones we know today. And he only had like 9 students when he started, okay? But he opened the doors. It was the first time that martial arts were being taught in an open door or in an opening environment. Before that, it was all the secrecy, of previous martial artists, right? And they were taught in families and all that, okay? So, and also he created a standard, which was a clear standard or transparent, okay? So there were no secrets. You could see what you were learning, and you knew what you were going to learn with the curriculum, okay? And in that time, when he opened the Kodokan studio, there were two people that joined, okay? And these two individuals were Shiro Saigo Sensei and Tomita Sensei.
Ambos no llegaron prácticamente desde cero, o sea, sin con ningún conocimiento marcial. Shiro Saigo había sido adoptado por una familia, que era una familia basada en el clan Aizu, y llega ya con conocimientos previos a formar parte de los primeros 9 alumnos de Jigoro Kano, y al igual que el señor Tomita, también llega con ciertos conocimientos también en el jujutsu que existía ahí, hacer parte de este Kodokan, porque creyeron en la propuesta deportiva de Jigoro Kano.
Okay, so when Jigoro Kano started, there were 9 students, and these 2 students were a part of those 9, okay, of those 9 first ones. But they both had some previous experience. They didn't get there as white belts, we could say, right? Even though we understand that the white is the apprentice and the black is the expert, they already had a background when they came in. Shiro Saigo was a part of the Iso clan, so he had some previous training in secrecy within the clan. And Tomita also had certain, background and training in the arts.
En esos tiempos no existían cinturones de colores, entonces no había que convalidar al alumno en qué grado venía llegando. Entonces es porque todo alumno que llegase con un cinturón blanco y mediante las clases iba aprendiendo.
So in that time there were no color belts, so everyone that came in started with a white belt, and when they, got to learn the whole thing, they will become black belts. So even though they had a previous background, they had to start like everybody else.
Con el paso del tiempo se dio cuenta que muchos alumnos, para darle al alumno la sensación de avance, de progreso, porque eran muchos años de entrenamiento antes de poder obtener un cinturón negro, para darle la sensación de que iba progresando y de que iba cumpliendo los requerimientos en el programa, porque sí existía un programa, se iba haciendo que cada uno de esos grados no fuese simplemente algo verbal, sino algo que él pudiese ver y experimentar en sus vestimentas. Entonces hace que el cinturón blanco, entre blanco y negro, hayan una escala de colores y crea así los grados Q.
Okay, so Jigoro Kano realized through the experience and through teaching, right? When he started teaching, the time started passing, and he realized that, there was a long period to go from white to black. Okay, there were many years that you need to train to get to black belt. Okay, so there was a curriculum. He already standardized that, okay, the teaching curriculum. But he realized that verbal acknowledgement wasn't enough in between white and black, right? Like you're here or you're here. So then he introduced the color belts and he introduced the Q ranks, so people could see where they were going.
La historia de ellos es una historia que es tremenda. Vamos a comenzar con Shiro Saigo. Él era una persona de estatura promedio baja, medía 1.50 m, considerando que en ese tiempo la estatura promedio del japonés era 1.65 m más o menos. Él era de contextura delgada, de peso ligero, y fue una persona muy bien adiestrada por Jigoro Kano, tanto así que se transformó en el... Recuerden que esto siempre lo he dicho en videos anteriores, que cada maestro tiene su brazo derecho y a la vez también tiene a su campeón dentro de las líneas como ejército, y en este caso dentro de las líneas como dojo. Y ese puesto era de Shiro Saigo, el del campeón.
Okay, so we need to go back to the history of each of these 2 individuals. So we're going to start with Shiro Saigo. Shiro Saigo was a small man, okay, not too tall. He was actually below average. He was like five feet tall, and the average was around 5'3 or 5'4, the Japanese height average at that time. And he was also a light, you know, a small individual, like a skinny guy, okay? But he was very, very well trained by Jigoro Kano, okay? And, you know, Sensei Axel has already told us that, you know, in that time, there were always a right-hand guy of the sensei and also a champion, okay? This was part of, like, the protocols inside the dojo. So Shiro Saigo was the champion, Jigoro Kano's champion, you could say.
¿Por qué la necesidad de tener un campeón? Ya que lo entrenó precisamente para ser un campeón, porque en esa época, una época muy convulsionada para Japón y sobre todo para los artistas marciales y sobre todo para los clanes, y este cambio de que las artes marciales, que por años habían sido símbolo de protección, hoy en día son prohibidas, se generaba mucha resistencia y sentimientos hasta de traición, porque Jigoro Kano se amoldeara al sistema, que desafiaban, iban al Kodokan Dojo y desafiaban abiertamente tener combates para probar que el judo no servía.
Okay, so why was there a need to have a champion and to train a champion? Because Shiro Saigo was trained to become one, and this was because in that era, in that time, you know, martial arts were forbidden, basically. The jutsus were forbidden, right? So Jigoro Kano, when he created this new type of art, who was more a sport, there was this feeling by the clans and the people that didn't know how to let go of this or how to adapt into this. They had this feeling of you know, being betrayed by Jigoro Kano because he adapted too fast, or he adapted very well to the new era, and they didn't know how. So they were, some of these individuals usually would go into the Kodokan Dojo and challenge, you know, the students there. So they were basically a lot of challenges going on in the dojo.
Precisamente, una de las personas, obteniendo grandes victorias ganaban muchos de los desafíos en los cuales se habían vuelto el Kodokan. Pero hubo una batalla que destacó, que era contra un oponente llamado Sakuhiro Yokohama, que era apodado el Oni. Oni significa demonio en japonés. Y esta persona era mucho más alto que el promedio de la... del promedio de la altura japonés, medía cerca de 1.75, que era bastante alto para la altura de la del hombre japonés, y con una contextura muscular mucho más fornida que Shiro Saigo, y desafía abiertamente en plena clase de Kano Jigoro, desafía, y Jigoro Kano acepta el desafío. Se pactan las reglas y el combate comienza.
Okay, so actually the students in the Kodokan Dojo had great success. They had many victories in a lot of the challenges that they were issued, that they had, you know, from different people. But there was one challenge that became you know, relevant, okay? And this was the one that it was done by Sakuhiro, or how was it, Sakuhiro?
Sakuhiro
Yokohama, sorry. And this individual, Sakuhiro Yokohama, who was nicknamed Oni, Oni in Japan means demon, okay? He was a taller guy, he was like around 5'9", 5'10". And he was a bigger structure, right? He was like stronger. And he got into the dojo and he issued a challenge that Jigoro Kano Sensei accepted. Un momentito, déjame mandar saludos. But before we continue, let me say hello to our friends. John Ward, hello, my amigos. Hola, hello, Sensei, hello, maestro. Marcelo Rodriguez. Good afternoon, maestros from Argentina. A big salute and an excellent talk today. Gracias. Saludos.
Abrazo, maestro Marcelo.
Maestro Bimbay Pineda. Buenas tardes, maestro Frank Soto. Buenas tardes, maestro Bimbay. Hasta la Baja California. Gracias por estar acá presente. Saludos, mi estimado. Okay, so Sakuhiro Yoko Hallens and Jigoro Kano accepted. Por favor.
El combate pactan las reglas propias del judo y comienza el combate. Comienza el combate y está escrito dentro de las crónicas porque fue el peleador Oni publicitó mucho antes de ir a desafiar porque precisamente tenía tanta confianza en que iba a, como representante del jiu-jitsu, iba a derrotar al judo. Tenía tanta confianza que publicitó mucho, mucha gente se acercó a mirar ese combate. Entonces quedó en los registros registrado de la siguiente manera: Oni o Yokohama, Sakuhiro Yokohama, muy confiado, se acerca hacia el pequeño y menudo, o sea, Chiro Saigo, y él se acerca, lo toma y hace una proyección que es conocido como el Yama Arashi, que consiste en un barrido de piernas, puesta la cadera y tomada del gi, y lo avienta, ¡paf!, de manera estrepitosa, violenta y explosiva. Muy sorprendido, el Oni se levanta nuevamente y nuevamente le uno, dos y ¡paf!, al suelo. Este combate se extendió por cerca de 30 minutos, en el cual el propio Oni, ya sin fuerzas, dice que se da por vencido.
Okay, so this was actually registered. This challenge, this combat, this fight was it's in the records because Sakuhiro Yokohama or Oni, he actually advertised it. He made it popular. He told everybody that he was going to fight because he was very confident that he was going to win. Okay, he was a bigger guy and he was a jiu-jitsu practitioner from a clan, right? From a secret school, from tradition. And he was going to be the Jigoro Kano judo, right? So he made it popular. So a lot of people went to see the fight. Okay. So when he got there, Oni got in front of Shiro Saigo and he walked to him and he grabbed him by the lapel and did
Yama Arashi.
Yama Arashi takedown, which is you grab by the lapel, okay, and there we go. Okay, we can see it on there on the screen. That's the Yama Arashi takedown, okay? Well, you pull him and you take him down. And he did that to Shiro Saigo, right? And he took him down, and Shiro Saigo immediately got up, okay? And Oni was impressed by this, so he did it again, and he got up again. So he did it again, and he got up again. And this went on for 30 minutes. 30 minutes of this until Oni was exhausted. He was so tired, he said, I give up. Wow.
En ese momento, se siente, crónicas de la época dicen que se siente muy avergonzado, y a la vez se siente derrotado y también se siente admirado, o sea, porque la calidad técnica era muy superior, y pide a Jigoro Kano que le acepte como alumno.
Okay, so it is written that Oni or Sakuhiro Yokohama felt ashamed. He felt very ashamed because he felt defeated. Okay, but he was also really impressed by the level of technique, you know, their mastery of the technique. And right after the fight, he asked Jigoro Kano to accept him as a student. Wow.
Llegó Logano, dijo, bienvenido.
Con una sonrisa, said,
con mucho gusto. No, le dijo bienvenido.
He said, you are welcome into the dojo.
Llegó Logano, tenía muchos haters dentro de la comunidad de artes marciales de Japón. Entonces él tenía claro que tenía que proyectarse hacia el exterior. Y hace un libro hablando del arte propiamente tal, y lo hace, en vez de escribirlo en japonés, lo hace en inglés.
Ok, so Jigoro Kano had a lot of haters, right, within the martial arts community in Japan. So he understood that he needed to project his art into the outside world. Okay, so he wrote his first book, or he wrote a book that it was not written in Japanese. He wrote it in English. Okay,
momentito. Claro, hi.
We have, tenemos saludos. Okay, Abimael Vega, salud from Chihuahua, Chihuahua. God bless, bendiciones, saludos.
Chihuahua, gracias, Abimael.
Catherine Letter Sumter, hello, Master Frank and Sensei Axel. I wonder if in Japanese culture, if having a lead student also created a healthy competition among the students like it does in the USA today.
Pregunta si, se pregunta si en la cultura japonesa el tener un estudiante líder o un campeón, si también eso creó una competencia saludable entre los estudiantes como lo es ahora en Estados Unidos.
Sí, precisamente la cultura japonesa y las artes marciales no es la excepción, está formada bajo la meritocracia, y parte de los méritos que tú vas obteniendo más enseñanzas y más secretos, y eso te motiva a que tú vayas compitiendo contigo mismo, pues, más que competir con aquel que se elige como el campeón, pues, porque se entiende que después del campeón tiene que haber un subcampeón. El campeón no es eternamente, ya que todo es transitorio.
Yes, Guru Catherine, Axel says yes, and actually this, yes, it generates that, and also we need to understand that the Japanese society, it's based upon meritocracy, okay, so you need to have to gain merits, so every time you are working more, and you're making more, and you're showing more interesting, more and more everything, secrets, or you are exposed to more knowledge, right? And also with competition. If you're competing more, but you're competing more with yourself, right? And by competing with other students as well, you are gaining merits, or, you know, you earn what you get. And that actually is still today. Okay, tenemos más comentarios. Mr. Patrick Kennedy, maestro, you are doing a great job for Kenpo, sir. Frank, thank you, sir. Thank you so much. But you are the guys that are doing everything. I'm just sharing. Thank you. Much appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you, Master Patrick.
Thank you. And it's a team effort, okay? We're doing a team. So we have Sensei Axel here, Hector Barbarie, Maestro Carlos Olmos, and we have a big team of people getting together, also Sensei Rodrigo Salas, and we're all working towards Kenpo and the martial arts in general. So thank you, sir. Yes. Mr. Noor, Mr. Soto, thank you for all you do. Greetings to the guest. Gracias y saludos al invitado. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
And Mr. Kennedy and Mr. Noor, you're both on my list. I will try to reach you later if you're interested in being on the podcast. Thank you. Jaime Jerez Enriquez, saludos, salud from Concepción, Chile.
Saludos, Maestro Jaime. Muchas gracias por comentar.
Ramón Soto Soto González, salud and God bless. Bendiciones, saludos, gracias. Okay, so... We were okay. So Mr. Kano did a book and published the book in English. That's where we were at.
Okay. El Master Yuro Kano, bueno, él, al igual que similar a lo que hizo el Grandmaster Parker, se dedica a la difusión del arte y deja a otra persona enseñando, como encargado de las clases y del dojo. La persona encargada de las clases y del dojo es precisamente el maestro Chiro, que es él, el que está ahí. ¿Se puede colocar la foto, maestro, por favor?
Claro que sí.
La historia que nosotros acabamos de hablar es él. Manténgalo ahí, por favor. Él fue la persona que durante varios años quedó como director del Kodokan Dojo, y hasta que llega un punto oscuro acá, que es un poco difícil de abordar, porque está narrado como que le da una dirección, o sea, él tenía todo, pero le da una dirección extraña a su vida, y termina dejando el judo y viviendo en otra ciudad más al sur del Japón, como comentarista en una revista, para comentarista de artes marciales en una revista, y ahí termina sus últimos días, y termina falleciendo mucho antes que el maestro Jigoro Kano. Y cuando el maestro Jigoro Kano sabe de la muerte de su campeón, de su champion, siente mucha pena y le da su grado póstumo de sexto dan, que era el grado máximo, el sexto dan. Todos estaban en quinto dan, los alumnos más antiguos. Y después de póstumo, le da el sexto dan. Ahora, maestro, la imagen que le compartí, que parece un certificado antiguo.
Ok. ¿Me permites?
Sí, claro.
Ok. So, similar to what, for example, Mr. Parker did in the U.S., Jigoro Kano also basically left the dojo to one of his senior students, and he dedicated his life to promoting or to the promotion of judo, okay? So he was, you know, traveling around and doing the promotion and all this thing to make his art more popular, right? To get more adepts. But in the dojo, in the Kodokan dojo, this individual that you see here, this is Chiro Saigo sensei. He was the head instructor at the Kodokan Judo for several years, okay? But after several years, for many years actually, his life had like a twist, and he moved into another city. He left judo, basically. He stopped teaching judo, and he became a speaker for the martial arts. He was actually worked in a magazine, and he did articles about the martial arts, so he became like us, I guess. Okay, so and after doing that, and he was working there, he passed away. And what happened, you know, Mr. Kano found out about his champion's passing, right? And of course he felt bad, and he gave him the sixth dan. Because that was the higher rank that you could achieve back then. All of his senior students were up only to fifth degree or fifth dan black belts, but he gave him his sixth dan as, you know, an honorary degree after his passing, basically after death. And that's what we see right here.
Yes. Ese certificado dice que Chiro, el maestro Chiro, adquiere el sexto dan de manera póstuma, con honores incluso, y como agradecimiento a su servicio, ayudó.
And that's the document we see here, where Chiro Saigo got his sixth dan black belt after that, and they gave it to him with honors, and with grateful for what he did for judo when he was alive.
Cabe mencionar que el grado máximo era quinto hasta ese entonces. no había ninguna persona que tuviera más de quinto, a excepción de Jigoro Kano.
Okay, so we got to say that the higher rank up until that time was fifth dan, and there was nobody above fifth dan besides Jigoro Kano, and he was the first issued sixth dan, but it was after his death.
Ahora nos vamos con el otro maestro, que es el maestro Yokohama, Sensei Yokohama.
Él. Now we're going to talk about the other individual that we have right here, which is Sensei Tomita, Tomita Sensei.
Tomita Sensei, Tomita Yokohama Tomita. Ah, no, Tomita, ah, I'm sorry, sorry, sorry. Tomita Sensei.
Tsunehiro, right? Tsunehiro, Tsunehiro. Tsunehiro Tomita Sensei.
Tsunehiro Tomita, I'm confused, I'm sorry. Okay.
Don't worry, that's why we're writing it down. Por eso lo apuntamos.
Él, precisamente, él, acá. Él fue, también, otro de los 9 primeros alumnos que tuvo el maestro Jigoro Kano, y él tenía, lo especial que él tenía era que sabía, dominaba, era muy colegiado y también dominaba el idioma inglés.
Okay, so, the individual, or the gentleman that we have right here in the picture, it's Tsunehiro Tomita Sensei. He was also a very well-educated man, and one of the he was a part of the first nine first students of the Kodokan Dojo, and the one particular thing he had is that he knew or he could speak English.
Él también tuvo combates en el Kodokan Dojo, luchando por el prestigio para poder ganarse su lugar. Y también le tocó pelear al igual que nuestro sensei anterior. Y él le tocó pelear contra Hansuke Nakamura, que él era un campeón de una escuela de jiu-jitsu también prestigiosa en aquellos años.
So, Tomita Sensei also got to fight, okay? He also went, had to fight in different challenges within the dojo. And he also had an important fight against Kazuke Nakamura, who was a prominent jujutsu practitioner, you know, from a clan, right? From another school, we could say.
Ese combate también ganó el maestro Tomita Sensei.
And in that combat, Tomita Sensei also won. He was victorious.
En la etapa donde Jigoro Kano quiere expandir más allá de las fronteras, él deja a Chiro Sensei y sale con Tomita Sensei hacia Estados Unidos. Y sale acompañado de una comitiva. Jigoro Kano acompañado del maestro Tomita y también acompañado de Mitsuyo Maeda hacia Estados Unidos. Okay. Y el resto.
So, as we said, Jigoro Kano left the dojo to start promoting his judo, and during that time when he left Shiro Saigo in charge of the Kodokan dojo, he went out and Jigoro Kano sensei visited the US, and he took with him a couple of his students. One was Tomita Sensei, and the other one was the famous Mitsudo Maeda.
Esto fue en 1905, y la otra persona que también acompañó a esta comitiva fue Chinchito Satake. Esa era la comitiva.
And there's actually a third student I was a part of this team that went out to the U.S., which was Chinchiro Sakati, or what was the name?
Chinchiro Satake.
Chinchiro Satake. Sorry about that. Chinchiro Satake was the other one who was a part of this, group that went into the U.S. To go and promote judo with their sensei, Jigoro Kano.
Esto consistía en charlas, como Jigoro Kano tenía en su mente, que el, como, o sea, tenía en su mente le, la, el concepto de que en Occidente, en esta parte del mundo, se enseñaba mediante discursos en universidades, discursos con gráficos, o sea, con gráficos, me refiero a con, que eran charlas más que cualquier otra cosa. Entonces fue preparado para eso. Sin embargo, hubo gente que cuestionó la eficacia de este sistema de artes marciales y le desafió a pelear.
So, when this happened in 1905, when they went to the U.S., Jigoro Kano Sensei was prepared to give talks about his art, judo, right, in universities and stuff like that, because that was his conception of the U.S., of the Western world, that they were more in that, into that format. So they went there and they went to give this talks, but the people in the U.S. started questioning his art and the effectiveness of the art, so they were also challenges that were issued to them.
Dicen los escritos que el maestro Tomita se encontraba lesionado de un hombro, producto de las clases, y, pero no importaba porque eran charlas solamente. Sin embargo, él decide tomar este desafío. No permite que su maestro Jigoro Kano lo tome, tampoco que el joven Mitsuyo Maeda tome este desafío. Él decide tomarlos y le va bien en varios, pero entiende que tiene que ser de cierta forma gentil con el adversario, porque la idea es que el judo agrade y que no se transmita la imagen de que quieren imponer superioridad.
So what happened was Tomita Sensei, who was a part of this group, he was actually injured, okay, because of training when they did this trip. But it didn't matter, right, because they were not going to go fighting. They were going to go and promote the art. But when the challenge were issued, he didn't allow his teacher to go into the challenge, of course, because, well, that was not the right thing to do, right? But also he didn't allow the younger Mitsuro Maeda to fight either. So even though he was injured, he stepped up and got into different challenges, and he actually won. But also he understood that they were there to promote the art, not to beat up everybody. So he had to do it in a gentle way and being nice to the adversary, respectful and nice, not to show them that they were superior and stuff like that. No, but they had he had to win playing a nice or a nicer, you know, fight.
En un combate en West Point contra un cadete de nombre Dali, el sensei pierde. Era un enorme jugador, era un enorme joven jugador de fútbol americano, enorme, o sea, ustedes saben. O sea, el fútbol americano tiene que tener una estatura bastante enorme. Y recuerden que ellos no superaban el metro 65, metro 70, tal vez.
¿Cómo se llamaba el...
Según la...
Ok, so, one of the challenges that Tomita Sensei had to fight was actually at West Point. And he did it against, I think it was a cadet or a soldier.
Cadete. Dali.
¿Dali con T?
D-A-L-Y.
Okay, so there was a cadet with the last name Dali, and this cadet was actually a football player, a huge man, right? You know, at West Point. And actually, Tomita Sensei lost this fight against this cadet at West Point. And we need to remember, you know, that the Japanese, this man, were a lot smaller, right? And a lot lighter than a football player, right?
Y la lesión del hombro.
And also he had that injury, that shoulder injury that Tomita Sensei had.
Esa fue su primera derrota en, las en tierras de Estados Unidos. La segunda fue en Casablanca, también a manos de un jugador de fútbol americano que también quería poner a prueba a estos extraños japoneses que venían a hablar de un sistema de artes marciales. Estas dos derrotas trajeron consecuencias para el honor del maestro Tomita.
So that was his first loss. No, he was defeated for the first time there at West Point, and there was also a second defeat that he had, that Tomita Sensei had, at Casablanca with another football player, with another humongous man, right, well-trained man, who beat him. Okay, and those two losses actually brought this honor into Tomita Sensei persona and career.
Maestro Tomita siente que él, con sus estándares personales, ustedes ya saben, japonés, siente que ha fracasado en querer darle el respectivo prestigio que el judo se merece. Entonces, el plan de Jigoro Kano era dejar a Maestro Tomita en Estados Unidos, que fundase una escuela ahí, y él nuevamente poder seguir expandiendo el judo en otras partes del mundo. Sin embargo, él dice, no, maestro Jigoro Kano, yo no estoy apto para esto. La gente de acá tiene una cultura diferente, son personas muy grandes, fuertes, y por ende demandan una condición física, que yo en este momento no tengo. So, así que, sorry, me devuelvo a Japón.
So, Tomita Sensei, you know, with his standards, he feels that he has failed judo, that he has failed the art to bring honor into the art, right? Because of these two losses. And the plan that Jigoro Kano had was, when he went to the U.S., was to leave Tomita Sensei in the U.S. and to have him open a dojo there and start teaching judo to the U.S. people. But Tomita Sensei declined. He said, no, Sensei, I'm sorry. I am not ready for this. This is a very different type of people in a different, you know, world. And they are too big. And the physical demands, I don't meet. I cannot meet these demands because, you know, of my age and shoulder or whatever. And so he declined and said, I'm going to go back into Japan. I cannot do this. And he said no.
Él vuelve a Japón, sigue ahí, sigue, continúa, o sea, cuando el maestro Chiro Sensei abandona, él sigue continuando, apoyando a los que están ahí, y ahí queda, sigue trabajando para el judo, él, pero en Japón. Esa sería la historia particular de los dos primeros cinturones negros. Ahora, veamos un tema aparte. Les mencioné que en esta comitiva iba el señor Mitsuyo Maeda. Él es conocido posteriormente como el Conde Koma. Todo lo que él vio, todo lo que su maestro Jigoro Kano hizo para promover el judo, llegar amablemente y mostrar un sistema de artes marciales gentil con ambas participantes, se sintió tan mal y lo tomó como un desafío personal, que Mitsuyo Maeda se llegó a Japón a fortalecerse enormemente para volver nuevamente. Y comenzó su campaña haciendo peleas por el mundo, desafiando a los distintos luchadores de distintas áreas, de distintos países.
Okay, so after the decision of Tomita Sensei of going back to Japan, he goes back into Japan and he continues to support and to teach at the Kodokan Dojo after the departure of that we already mentioned of Shiro Saigo. So he stayed there and he just continued to do judo there, right? But we also mentioned that a part of this team was Mitsuro Maeda, later known as Count Koma, right? The famous or infamous Mitsuro Maeda, right? What happened was, after he witnessed all this, right? He was there and he saw all this. He took it very personal, right? He was upset of what had happened. So he went back into Japan and worked And I started training harder and harder and got, you know, stronger. And because he took this challenge, this idea that, you know, he wanted to go back. And that's what he did. When he went back to Japan, he got bigger, he got stronger, he got more training. And then he went into the world and started challenging people all over the place to show the superiority of their art. Okay, vamos a mandar saludos. Okay, so Mr. Neuer said, sounds great. Thank you. Okay, sir. We'll talk to you soon. We'll reach to you. Thank you. Marcelo Cagido Rodriguez, Igor Okano, besides being a great visionary and a great spirit of kindness and cordiality and help, he also helped the great Gishin Funakoshi sensei, including Ueshiba O-sensei, and he left a legacy for all the next generations. Gracias, maestro.
Así es, maestro Marcelo. Muchas gracias. Sí, un visionario que aportó mucho a artes marciales y le debemos mucho. Aunque ninguno de nosotros haya practicado judo, le debemos harto mucho respeto a él. Muchas gracias por su comentario.
Thank you for the comments. Yes, you're right, maestro Marcelo. Mr. Kano was a visionary for sure, and we owed him, even though we never practiced, even if we're not judo practitioners, we owe him a great deal for what he did for the martial arts because of, you know, his work. Juan Martín Álvarez, saludos, maestro. Saludos, master.
Saludos, maestro. Saludos, maestro Juan Martín.
Yermis Caraballo. This historical knowledge is very good that because it gives us awareness and consciousness of what happened. Yes, sir. Thank you. Gracias.
Thank you, Master Yermis. Entonces, todo lo que dio Mitsuyo Maeda, la cierta desventaja en complexiones es la compensa sobreentrenándose, y por eso tenemos fotos del Conde Coma así, en el cual él se preparó físicamente para poder equiparar estos tremendos jugadores, estos tremendos tipos que hicieron que el Sensei Tomita no lograse su misión. Y esto termina gatillando, miren las cosas de la vida, mis hermanos, termina gatillando en que él termina siendo refugiado en Brasil por la familia Gracie, y termina agradeciendo, dándoles el mayor regalo que él tenía. No tengo dinero, no tengo posesiones, te daré un regalo superior. Enseñaré ayuda a tus hijos.
O Kano, ¿qué quieres? After witnessing all this, he went back and trained, and that's what we see him in the picture with, you know, he got this big muscles and he got ready, right, to go and challenge everybody. So that this was a product of his training after what he saw, right? So he went out into the world and you know, he became famous. You know, he traveled to Spain, Mexico, the U.S. He traveled all over the place, and he ended up in Brazil, basically, right, where a person there of the last name Gracie helped him out, right? And he helped him with the legal status because he got married there, he made a life there, and he helped him. The Gracie, I think it was Gustavo Gracie, helped him out, and Mitsuyo Maeda, to contribute back, he gave him the best thing he had, which was Kano's jiu-jitsu or judo, and he taught them, and that's where the Gracie history comes. So that's why this is also important.
Eso es todo por hoy. Muchas gracias a todos.
Okay, so that's it for today. That's actually a very nice story. Muchas gracias, Axel. Yo tengo una pregunta. ¿En qué claro. momento se convierten estos dos individuos en los primeros cinturones negros? I'm asking him at what at particular moment these two individuals that we see on the pictures in the back right there, they became the first black belts.
No estoy del todo seguro, pero la fecha anda entre 1885 y 1887.
Okay. He says, I'm not totally sure, but the date of what of that was around 1885 and 1887.
Approx.
Nice. And these were the first two issued black belts?
Sí, se promovieron juntos. Se promovieron juntos.
Okay, they got promoted at the same time, and they were, that's what made them seniors of the rest of the students.
Entonces fueron las primeras personas en hacer esta carrera y licenciarse en artes marciales. ¿Por qué eso representaba el cinturón negro? Ser ya licenciado titulado en artes marciales.
So these were the first two people that finished their career and got the degree, which is like a bachelor's degree, which that's what represented the black belt. So they were the first one to get the degree of black belts in judo, these two men. Catherine Letter Sumter says, great talk. Thank you, Bo. Thank you, girl. Thank you. You're the best. And also, I didn't mention Catherine. She's also part of the team. También parte del equipo. Catherine Letter Sumter, also one of
always, our... Always see your comment is my I feel having. Thank you, Master Catherine, for your comments.
She's part of the team, and also Maestro Scott Higgins has helped a lot with doing all this. So thank you, everybody. Muchas gracias a todos. Thank you, everybody, for helping out. Gracias, Sensei. Excelente programa. Muy buena información. Thank you. And, well, guys, next week we have, actually, next week we have surprises for you. Yes. Let me make sure who's going to be here, but I think I can let everybody know because they will see the promotion, the advertising, the flyer for the next session. So next week on Tuesday, we're going to have back here in the show, Mr. Bry Cooper, Kempo Maestro. He's going to be again with us. But on Thursday the 15th, we have confirmed that we're going to have with us none other than the living legend, Bill Superfoot Wallace is going to be here in the podcast. Yes, sir. We're very happy. He's going to be here on April 15th, so don't miss it. Yes, yes. I'm a fan. So, yes. But before we go, we have a question. Marcelo dice una pregunta, maestro, a question for the Sensei Axel. These two black belts, these two first black belts, did they have students in judo, descendencia? Did they create a lineage?
Kano Jigoro Sensei formó muy bien a sus alumnos, lo formó muy bien, y dentro de eso lo formó el concepto de que Kodokan Judo y el Judoka son todos una gran familia. Por ende, son todos... descendencia marcial, pues hasta el día de hoy, sí, sí, pero no, por lo menos ellos no dejaron el Kodokan y se colocaron como una escuela de línea aparte, no, siguieron bajo la misma gran casa, pues el Kodokan, la casa del camino.
So, Jigoro Kano did an amazing job teaching and educating his students. So, yes, these two gentlemen were a part of the Kodokan Judo, and they never left. So yes, there is a legacy, but they're all part of the same family. So of course, I mean, being there and so on, but they don't have like an individual legacy because they never left and they always stay there. So they're all part of the same Judo legacy from Mr. Kano. Gracias. Catherine Sumter says, wow, Superfoot. Yes, I know, right? So, gracias a todos. Thank you very much. Maestro, Sensei, gracias.
Saludos.
Everybody, have a great weekend. See you tomorrow on Open Mat Talks. And next week, don't miss Coffee and Martial Arts. We're going to have an amazing, amazing show. Take care. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Shinobio. 目覚めてください。 あなたの主のために。
Diga, thank you.
Thank you. I see you the next Friday.
Bye-bye.